3 games into the season, and I already think the Lakers have been far more entertaining and controversial than anyone possibly could have imagined. Alright, so the Lakers lost once again last night, and this time it was to the San Antonio Spurs in overtime, and people have been losing their minds about it. And it's not even just because the Lakers lost that has people so shook, but more so about how the Lakers lost. As with 12 seconds left in overtime and the Spurs up 1, this happened.
Yep, came up a little short on that one.
Yep,
this one's huge.
This one is really big now.
Because that idiot.
LeBron James missed both free throws, and the Lakers will go on to lose the game. And like I said, this has had people losing their mind, with Legend of Winning sarcastically asking if LeBron James has a no trade clause and also tweeting out, "So we took another L and LeBron is looking sus, man's missing free throws and layups." Then Dom2k was out here posing the question of, will these 3 early losses in the season come back and bite LeBron in the long run now that he's in the West? And with every game being so pivotal, one loss here or there is the difference between you making and missing the playoffs. Though he later did bring up a good point about the Jazz starting off last year 19-28 and then finishing out the season as one of the better teams in the Western Conference and making the playoffs. And then on top of this, you already know that guys like Skip Bayless and Stephen A. Smith are going to have a field day talking about LeBron James's performance. And that's pretty much where we stand in the current state of the Los Angeles Lakers affairs. They're 0-3, despite LeBron James making that clutch 3 to send the game to overtime in the first place. He couldn't come up with the free throws to win it, and look, I just think it's crazy how people are reacting to the loss as opposed to if the Lakers had just lost to the Spurs in regulation by a couple of points. If that were to have happened, I don't think anyone would have been too surprised, because the Spurs, guess what, are a really good team, and the Los Angeles Lakers are still trying to figure everything out. But because they almost beat the Spurs and didn't, it's the end of the world. Anyways, that's just my quick 2 cents on all the drama that's going on right now. As for the Lakers, they aren't happy with this loss at all. And not just because it sends them to 0-3 on the year, but also because they feel like the refs and the officiating of the game is what cost them the win. I mean, Luke Walton absolutely went off on the refs after the game, saying the guys of the Spurs are flopping 30 feet away from the rim just so they can try and get a call.
Zero. So to me, it doesn't matter. I know they're young, I get that, but if we're gonna play a certain way, let's not reward people for flopping 30 feet from the hole on plays that have nothing to do with that possession. They're just flopping just to keep, see if they get a foul call. And then not reward players that are physically going to the basket and getting hit. It's not right.
And then LeBron James also admitted that it's really hard to play defense in today's NBA when you're not allowed to touch anyone. Actually, he said you can't touch people, but I guess just not everyone else. You can touch anyone with the Lakers, you can be fine.
Still doing a lot of fouling. It's hard. It's just hard with the new rule changes. You literally can't touch anybody. Well, you can. You can touch somebody, but defensively, you just can't. There's nothing. We don't know. We're trying to figure it out. But every time we're on a defensive end, especially in the third quarter, we just kept putting them to the free throw line. But we got to try to figure that out.
So just 3 games into the season and refs are already coming under fire for the way games have been officiated. I think that has to be a new record. And I think you can see why the Lakers are upset here. When you think or you know that you're getting fouled, but the refs don't call it, and then on the other end of the court, you get called for a foul for just trying to play defense on a guy who isn't even involved in the play, that's going to get under your skin, especially if it happens a couple of times throughout the night. But then on the other end of the spectrum here, you have guys like Jalen Rose, Mr. 81, saying that these things were happening on both sides, and that the amount of fouls called for both teams were pretty even at the end. And despite what the Lakers think about the refs from yesterday, it was the refs who gave the Lakers a chance to win the game in overtime, but LeBron missed his free throw.
We're talking about the officiating post-game, yet LeBron James, the best player in the world, was actually standing where? When he had a chance to put his team
on the
up,
foul line,
and he missed both of them. Bron didn't get a call multiple times. I feel like Josh Hart didn't get a call multiple times. However, the same thing happened with DeMar DeRozan. The same thing happened with LaMarcus Aldridge. That's what happens in the game of basketball. But when you look at the totality of the fouls, The Lakers were called for 29. The Spurs were called for 26. It was only a three-point disparity.
Controversy everywhere already. We're only 1 week into the season, guys, and all of this is already happening. Even though the outcome of the season might already be decided with the Golden State Warriors more than likely going to win the NBA championship once again, this actual season itself is probably going to be one of the most entertaining that we have ever seen. But of course, that wasn't the only game from yesterday, so now let's take a look at everything else that went on in the NBA. Even though it's just been four games so far, Kyle Lowry has been one of the most efficient players in the NBA throughout these first four games, averaging 21 points and 10 assists on 60% shooting from the field and 58% shooting from three. And the Raptors as a whole are probably just one of the most efficient offensive teams in the NBA, as they now remain undefeated on the year after trouncing the Hornets 121-106. Toronto has been moving the ball really well, finding the open man, not turning the ball over much, rebounding well, defending well, shooting well. They're just playing at a much higher level than any other team in the league right now. And the Milwaukee Bucks so far this season are making their case to be that other team in the Eastern Conference that can compete with both Boston and Toronto. Look, I'm still not going to put them on the same level as those other teams simply because my concerns about their depth of their bench still hold true. In the playoffs, both the Raptors and the Celtics would have the edge on the Bucks simply because they are much more talented teams. But that's not to say that this can't change. Once the playoffs start to draw near and guys start getting bought out and released from their contracts, the Bucks could pick up one or two quality players and bring them off the bench to help shorten the gap between them and the Celtics and the Raptors. But even if they don't, with Giannis Antetokounmpo and Chris Middleton playing the way that they've been playing to start the season, even without a great bench, it's not going to be easy for anyone to beat the Bucks right now. If you haven't watched the Bulls play yet this season, I would highly suggest that you do so simply to watch Zach LaVine play. If the Wolves had him instead of Andrew Wiggins, Jimmy Butler wouldn't be trying to leave Minnesota right now. Butler wants to play with guys who have a fire, and Zach LaVine has that fire. You can see that he wants to win so badly when he's out there playing, and he always had the Bulls within inches of winning, but he just needs a little bit more help. So maybe when marketing comes back, the Bulls can start turning some of these narrow losses into wins. Zach LaVine had his third straight 30-point performance yesterday, though, with 34 points on 11 of 15 shooting and 5 of 7 shooting from deep. Man is averaging over 32 points per game right now while shooting 62% from the field and 45% from three. There's no way that he keeps this up, but still, he's proving his worth to the team already. Anyways, it was the Mavericks who would go on to win this game 115-109. Luka Doncic scoring 19 points to go along with 6 assists. And here is a game that I'm sure Celtics fans would like to forget with the quickness, as they just lost to the Orlando Magic 93-90. And the story is, Boston just couldn't hit a shot, shooting 40% from the field and only making 9 of their 43-point attempts. Orlando, on the other hand, was led by Nikola Vucevic, who has gotten off to a great start this year as he put up 24 points and 12 rebounds, and second-year pro Jonathan Isaac having one of the better games of his career so far with 18 points and 12 rebounds. Not really too much to say about this game. The Warriors had their way with the Spurs from the opening tip and eventually came away with a 123-103 win, and watching the Warriors so far, they still look really good, don't get me wrong. But at the same time, you can watch them and tell that they're not even trying yet. And they still don't even have DeMarcus Cousins back yet either. So this is pretty much the equivalent of Frieza being just in his first form. Andrew Wiggins had to leave this game early with a right quad contusion, so hopefully he's able to come back quickly from this minor injury. But regardless of that, the Wolves still got the win yesterday over the Indiana Pacers 101-91. And for Indy, there was a lot of fuss about the improvement of Miles Turner over the summer, you know, with his whole transformation body-wise, working out with Victor Oladipo's trainer. A lot of fuss about Miles Turner so far. They even rewarded him with the $80 million contract, but I personally haven't seen the improvement yet, so let's hope that changes. LeBron James wasn't the only player missing key free throws down the stretch yesterday, as John Wall also missed a pair that could have given the Wizards a much more comfortable lead in the final seconds. But luckily for him, Damian Lillard wasn't able to make the most out of it, and the Wolves escaped Portland with their first win of the season, 125-104. Bradley Beal with 25 points, 8 rebounds, and 7 assists for Washington. And lastly, the Jazz went ice cold from the field and lose to the Grizzlies. 92 with the 84. Mike Conley scoring 23 on the night. And that is going to bring us to the player of the day, where you guys can vote on who you think had the best performance of the night by clicking the little eye icon in the top right hand corner of the video. Just remember though, the only players whose team won are eligible to win player of the day. And yes, that player had to be Trae Young with his 35 points and 11 assists. But that is gonna do it for everything that we had to talk about today, guys. Leave a like on the video if you enjoyed the video, and also subscribe to the channel with post notifications turned on so you can stay up to date with everything that goes on in the NBA on a daily basis. Thank you once again for watching though. You guys already know that you are the real MVPs. And until tomorrow, I'm out of here. Peace.